action. I'll post the videos this weekend. I'll send out the, I'll work on the midterms too, so you have them, but I'll clarify what the strategy is going to be this time. So the strategy will be the week of the exam, on Monday, Wednesday, Friday. The Monday class will be provide you with the problems and work through the applications. On Wednesday, there'll be computer or research-related questions, so you'll be doing a computer lab. And then, based on recommendations from our senior executive team, that on Friday we do a group project where you basically put together a global stock or bond portfolio, preferably a stock portfolio, so you'll have to construct it. The idea would be to, what is your assessment? You know, what is your target assets under management or AUM? And then the fees that you're going to charge on that. You're going to have to come up with country allocations. And then I'll go over different country allocation strategies. At the end of the lecture, I'll go over that. Company selection and allocation. Is it going to be a large cap or a mid cap or a small cap strategy? So you're going to have to come up with what the strategy is going to be. Is it income? Is it growth? Is it hybrid between income and growth? So you've got to state, you know, what the portfolio strategy is. What is the attribution? What do you expect to get in regards to return from your country exposures, from your industry exposures, and from your company selection approaches? So you got to give me kind of a breakdown, you know, of the attribution analysis. Again, you don't have to run it. I just want to see if you understand, you know, if your expected rate of return on the portfolio is 18 to 22%, how much of the total return is going to be made up of country allocation and country selection, how much is industry selection and allocation, and how much is company selection and allocation. The fund strategy, again, you're going to have to state what the strategy is. Who are you marketing this fund to? Is it institutional? Is it retail that you're going after? Is it high net worth market? You know, who are the investors that we're looking to accumulate the assets under management? And I would be shooting for at least, you know, $20 billion in assets under management. That could be easily done. And you could probably go up to 200. Billion, but it would probably take you at least, you know, 5 to 10 years to be able to get that much money, you know, under management. I know it's funny, but we're talking about, yeah, this is the real world, okay? And then applications of portfolio insurance. You know, what types of derivative trades would you use to be able to hedge off the different types of exposures, particularly, not necessarily interest rate risk, but definitely foreign market risk. So you're going to have to identify which benchmarks you're going to use to be able to, you know, write, you know, the forwards and the futures on to be able to do it. And then if you're using, you may even want to say, I want to do an augmented fund where we actually select, we do selection, a custom portfolio, but you may also say, we also want to do a fund of funds approach. And what you'll do is you'll put together a fund of funds using ETFs, or a fund of funds using global macro funds. So you could do that too. Because the idea at the end of the day is for us to be able to sell this as a GTC branded product, to be able to go out and roll out basically a product line of international fund offerings that we can sell both to institutional investors and retail investors. Okay, so again, I would like also to see if you understand, if you do put together a fund, what is the alpha and the beta of the fund? Of course, you know, if the market, if you pick a benchmark index, you calculate the return on the index, that's going to be the benchmark. And obviously, and hopefully, you can beat the international benchmark, maybe the Morgan Stanley benchmark or some other types of international equity benchmarks. And you got to get at least 200 basis points above the benchmark to be able to get the assets, you know, under management, under an active trading strategy or active management strategy. Or you can just say, hey, you know, we'll do an active management strategy for 250 to 300 basis points that will charge on AUM. Or what we can do is do what BlackRock did or Barclays did and just roll out a bunch of index funds, you know, or a bunch of indexed ETFs based on the benchmarks, and we can lower the fees to about 100 basis points on that. So I'm looking for some creativity in the design here of the products. You gotta be able to forecast too, currency appreciation rates, because if the dollars depreciate, if you're forecasting a depreciation of the dollar and appreciation of foreign currency, that foreign currency appreciation is gonna be tacked on to the expected return on the portfolio. So it's gonna get juiced by the appreciation. So if you can forecast the expected return on the portfolio along with the exchange rate component, that would be pretty awesome too. You're gonna have to write, list what the rules are or the criteria in which you're using to be able to select. The ETFs or the mutual funds, if you're doing a fund-to-fund, or what is the criteria in which you use to be able to select the individual ADRs to be able to build the foreign equity portfolio, and then give me the weights. What is your country weights, what's your industry weights, and what's your individual company weights? That would be ideal. And then I'll go over country weights a little bit later, because you can use population or quality of life or export trade, GDP or FDI inflows, and maybe stock market capitalization as the weighting factors for the individual countries. I'd also like to see exit strategies. What would be the criteria in which you would take a stock out of your fund? What rules, you know, would the criteria have to be to jettison a stock out of your fund? Is it, you know, financial accounting manipulation? Is it corporate governance violations? Is it lawsuit, you know, consumer lawsuits or something? You know, what is it that would jettison it out? And then when you're doing the allocations, you should state a minimum and maximum allocation so you can get a range. You know, so you can allow the markets to float within a range, both by country and by industry and by company. So you usually set, you know, a min-max, you know, on the allocations, and then you have a target allocation, a model allocation for the model portfolio. Does everybody understand what I just said, or did I speak over everybody's head? Do you understand what I was talking about? Do you understand what we're trying to do here? Go for it.
I would, like, I know what you're talking about, but I don't really know how I would put together a portfolio or anything like that. Are we going to work on metal together? Or like,
yeah, we'll continue that discussion.
Okay.
I mean, what I would do, since you don't know how to do it, go find somebody who has done it. Go up to BlackRock's International or Global ETF Fund and go read the, you know, the bios of the fund managers. I read the rules and the strategy associated with fund construction, and then look at the performance of the fund, both on a expected return basis, but also on a 1, 3, 5, 10-year basis if the fund's that old. And that way you can get annualized return performance. And then they usually will give you the standard deviation and the risk-adjusted rate of return or the Sharpe ratio or the beta, you know, of the portfolio. So I would go find funds that have already been done and use those as models to be able to put together your fund strategy. That answer your question?
Kind of, yeah.
Oh, you know, we'll go through it a little bit more. Okay.
Do we just have to be able to explain why we chose those funds, or is there like something we need to follow to choose one fund?
Well, first you want to have a strategy on country, right? Country and currency, but first, what countries do you want to target? And then the second is what industries within those countries do you want to, you know, allocate into? And And then within those industries, you're gonna pick, you know, the companies, and either they're gonna be large cap, mid cap, or small cap, right? Do you want a small cap strategy and high growth industries and emerging markets? There's your strategy right there. Or do you wanna appeal to a more institutional conservative investor, more risk averse, where you're gonna go into established, you know, developed countries, you know, in stable industries into large cap, you know, ADRs, right? So what's your strategy? Is it income? Is it growth? Is it a hybrid between income and growth? So you gotta be able to communicate, you know, what your fund strategy is gonna be, and that's gonna be the overarching strategy in which you're going to then sell that fund to the retail or institutional investors based on their suitability. Because I can't sell, you know, high growth, high risk, you know, funds to institutional investors, you know, unless they have a, you know, a risk allocation component, you know, in their overall portfolio strategy. So we may be targeting the institutional market, but the risky, high growth niche component. So when you read these funds, they're going to tell you what the strategy is around these funds. Go for it. It's up to you to decide how you want to do it. You can do a hybrid between growth and income. You could do growth, you could do income. It really depends on what you want to do.
Or balance.
You could do balance too. I mean, this is a fully invested fund. There's no cash and there's no bonds. Okay, I want it to be pure equities. And we'll do, for the final, we'll focus more on fixed income stuff. Okay? Is that a little better?
I think so, yeah.
Okay. Go for it. No, you're going to work on
how they do in that class, or do
more? Yeah, I would, and you're going to do them in groups at three, so you'll have more resources. But I'll set it up and send you the stuff so you can read and think about it and do some preliminary research. And then you should be able to write it up. I guess one person can type it up. But you're going to have to be able to do it like in an hour, so you're going to be able to have to allocate your time. And you can bring, if you want, you can bring some stuff in. I mean, I don't care. I think if this is too important of an exercise, if you want to spend more time outside the class doing it, that would be fine. Because I think it's just, you know, this is just a cool project. Okay. Any other questions? No. Okay. I'll go through a little bit more. You know what we're going to do on the exam, and then we have the schedule here. I'm not going to waste time on the schedule. You guys can take a picture of that and go through it. I want to go through the presentation and then spend more time on the applications. So what we're going to talk about is international correlation. Really, it's all in the correlation and the covariance when you're building a diversified portfolio. And you can get diversification within the portfolio if you're investing in countries and markets and companies, you know, whose returns have low, no, and negative correlation with each other. And if you can do that, it's going to bow out the efficient frontier, reduce the expected return, reduce the risk more, and get higher risk-adjusted rates of return, you know, for the investors at some hurdle rate. And the international portfolios, since they're more volatile and riskier than domestic portfolios, you have to have a higher expected return threshold. So your benchmarks, I don't know what the benchmarks are, your returns on these international funds, would be interesting to see. What some of the ETFs, you know, have performed over the last 1, 3, 5 years, but my assumption too is a lot of these international funds are relatively new, particularly on the ETF side. So like the Morgan Stanley fund's been around a long time, it's a seasoned fund. There's been a Japanese fund around for a long time. So I would look at the seasoned fund and then look at the new funds and see how they perform and how they segment out and which ones are providing the highest return. And obviously it's gonna be emerging markets, it's gonna be small cap companies in those emerging markets and high growth industries that are going to be, it's going to be the most volatile but provide the highest rate of return. So we'll talk about optimal portfolio selection, we'll talk about effects of exchange rates on returns, we'll talk a little bit about bond investments, we'll talk about mutual funds, country funds, ADRs, ETFs, hedge funds, and then home bias with a little bit of that, and then international diversification with small caps. we could design and we could market, we could distribute through our GTC channels, the mutual funds, we could do that product. We could do country funds. We could manage ADRs on behalf of our clients and trade them on behalf of our clients. And we could build and design ETF product and distribute that too. So there's multiple channels of revenue that we can generate through these equity products. And then GTC really does also, because we have a retail and a private equity institutional arm, we basically look and smell like a hedge fund, but we don't call ourselves a hedge fund. Okay? We're basically a diversified product offering company that does both public and private equity and debt that we do. We can sell retail products, but we can also do private equity stuff too, more custom stuff. And we do have a real estate arm too, and we do investment banking. Globally, on both the fixed income and the equities. We can do it all, right?
Yeah.
We can do it all. Well, you might as well, if you're going to engineer, you know, the badass company, you might as well engineer the badass company, right? It's only going to be limitations, you know, on your intellectual capital, you know, in your team and your clients, you know, that are going to limit your success and your ability to scale the company. Okay, so international foreign equities. It was only a really small market in the 90s, about $250 billion. It's now currently about over $5 trillion in international equity. So just scaling over time, which is internationalization and free capital flows, along with multinational corporate interests. When you're forecasting the returns, you know, on your portfolio, you're going to build a regression model. Okay, if you have a track record in your fund, the return over time. You can build the factors, you can figure out the factors that are going to drive return. Again, what are the factors that are going to drive return? It's going to be one, the portfolio selection capabilities, and it's going to be your industry selections, two are going to be a major component. And then obviously there's got to be a currency component in here, because that's part of the total overall return. You can do time series if you have a track record in your fund to build a forecast model. Sometimes you don't have that, and you can estimate the expected returns by using a cross-sectional regression model called a multi-factor model, which is also called the arbitrage pricing theory. So for those of you who had the investments class, you probably have been exposed to a cross-sectional. So what we would do in that case is we would have the factors and we'd do it across firms or across industries or across countries to be able to get the factors and then make the projections on the factors and then calculate the return using the cross-sectional approach as opposed to a time series approach. So I'll probably test you on that. So really the key to international diversification is really putting together those low or negative correlated stocks. The correlations amongst stock markets, before it was pretty easy to get diversification because a lot of these markets were not correlated because it wasn't an open economy and it wasn't integrated. And really central bank integration, coordination was a huge factor in increasing the correlation amongst the stock markets across the globe. So correlation was really low in the 80s. Markets were opaque and efficient. And the correlations have increased significantly. So that just means that it's becoming harder and harder to gain diversification within a global context because of the convergence and correlations. Let's see. So when you're building the portfolio, and again, this is that same chart, right, where as you add more assets to the portfolio that have internationally that have low, no, and negative correlation, it's going to reduce the unsystematic risk or the market. Unsystematic risk or company-specific risk within the portfolio so that the only thing that's left is the beta or the systematic risk. And the beta is the covariance divided by the variance. International markets with high-low correlations, U.S. and Canada, that makes sense, right, because they're on the border. Germany and Netherlands, again, so geographic proximity to markets obviously creates high correlations. UK, Netherlands, Netherlands, and Switzerland, that all makes sense. We probably have a high correlation with Mexico. Australia, Italy, these are the low correlated markets. Australia, Italy, Australia, and Japan. Germany, the UK, Hong Kong, Italy, Japan, Sweden, the US, Japan. So we were really going to focus on low correlation and really drive down the portfolio standard deviation and hit that expected return on the portfolio, the risk adjusted. So this would probably be for institutional risk averse investors. That would be the strategy. We invest in markets with low correlations to each other to really drive down the portfolio risk. And if we can hit the hurdle rate of 18 to 22%, our risk adjusted rate of return will go up significantly. And we'll get a ton of money from institutional investors that are risk averse. If you want to take on more risk, you probably want to invest in markets that are highly correlated to each other because we're taking on more risk. And investors are going to want to be compensated for the, for that additional risk and the increase in the covariance within the portfolio. I'm probably going to test you on this too. We've already done this before, but not really in detail in the portfolio context. So when you're putting together an international portfolio, equities, they could be equities and debt, let's just do a mixed asset portfolio. 100% international bonds, 100% equities, if you want to get more return in your portfolio, and you're willing to take on more risk, you sell off your international bond portfolio and buy more international stocks. If you want to reduce your risk, you're willing to take a lower return, you can sell off your international equity portfolio, and you're going to buy more international bonds. You can juice the expected returns of the portfolio by adding margin to it to borrow funds. So you can jump off the efficient frontier and move up the capital allocation line to get higher expected returns on the portfolio by using leverage. You can also jump off the efficient frontier and move down the capital allocation line by shorting your securities or lending, which you're lending the securities out. So by shorting, you can jump off the efficient frontier and move down the capital allocation line. Risk-averse investors obviously want high returns and low risk. There's nothing out there in the marketplace, so they're going to have to reduce their utility to get to the international market basket. And you could use, theoretically, you could use the Morgan Stanley Index, the MSCI, you can use other indexes as basically the proxy for a market portfolio. But you'd have to actually combine that with a global bond index to be able to get the true market basket. If you do a good job in your bond and your stock selection process, country allocations, industry allocations, and selections of the stocks and the bonds. Through international diversification, you do get the low, no, and negative correlations. Theoretically, it should bow out the efficient frontier and reduce the expected return on the portfolio, but also reduce the portfolio standard deviation significantly. And therefore, the expected return on the global portfolio divided by the standard deviation on the global portfolio. This would be reduced, but this would be reduced even more, which means your risk-adjusted rate of return on the portfolio goes up in the institutional risk of the first investors. You can also bow out the efficient frontier by applying portfolio insurance, such as using derivative as the tools, and you write forwards and you write futures and you write calls on futures by puts on futures, but you're not only doing that on the prices of the stocks and the prices of the bonds, but you're also hedging off the currency risk simultaneously. So you have another layer of derivatives that you would be applying to the currencies. So currency exchange rate appreciation need to be taken into consideration when you're calculating the return on the portfolio. And the return on the portfolio is going to be the return on the equities times the appreciation of the currency exchange rate. So 1 plus the return, 1 plus the return, minus 1. So you have your exchange rate component, which is going to be this piece right here. Here's an example. As a U.S. resident, you sold British shares. You got a 15% rate of return in pounds. You got a 5% depreciation rate on the exchange rate. And your rate of return is going to be, in this case, it's going to be 1 plus 0.15, 1 minus the 0.05, minus 1 is going to give you 0.925. You can see that it's just a subtraction of the depreciation component. You need to also be able to calculate the portfolio standard deviation. So you have to be able to calculate the variance. The variance is going to be the variance on the portfolio, the variance of the exchange rate, 2 times the covariance between the exchange rate and the return, and then the change. This is the contribution cross product term that also needs to be added in there. The effects of changes in the exchange rate or risk is really the fluctuations due to the risk in the foreign investment. So there's 3 channels where the risk comes in. One is the volatility, and the covariance, and the change in the contribution. When you're trying to figure out the yields on the bonds, particularly international bonds, you obviously have to start with the risk-free rate. So you're probably going to use some weighted, risk-free, global weighted risk-free rate, and then you start tacking on the risk premiums. So obviously credit default, risk premiums, we'll focus on this stuff, you know, towards the final. I want to do the applications at the end and really focus on the fixed income market. So obviously credit default, illiquidity, theoretically, emerging market debt's going to be more illiquid, so the risk premiums are going to be higher. Also, the companies in those emerging markets are probably going to have higher default, credit default risk premiums too. Maturity, some of these countries can only issue bonds at certain maturities because of the lack of liquidity across the curve. And obviously, for FX, foreign currency, exchange rate risk need to be put in there. Taxes have to be adjusted. Different countries have different tax regimes. And then obviously policy and political risk premiums, and maybe other risk premiums that you have to tack on to estimate the expected yield on your bond portfolio or on the individual bonds. Oh, and then country risk. You also need country risk there also. And then as I just talked about, you can hedge your portfolio by using, writing the forward contracts and the futures contracts and entering into swap, currency swap contracts. So we probably want to add that, you know, into the derivative trades now, is both the interest rate and the currency swap contracts. So if you look at the risk, you know, in the markets, particularly for the bonds, it's going to be Australia bonds are providing the highest returns, Japan and Germany, and then the ones that are providing the lowest returns are the UK, Canada, and the US. Sorry, this is actually not return, this is the variance. So Australia volatility, Japan and Germany, and UK, Canada, and the US. And that makes sense here, right, because Germany and Japan over the last 7 years have entered into negative interest rate policy. So the volatility is a lot wider than the US, in volatility in the yields, because they have a wider spread. International mutual funds, these are US-based international mutual funds. There's advantage to these, particularly transaction information costs are a lot lower. You can circumvent legal and institutional barriers. I mean, some institutional investors can't invest directly in international shares. They have to do it through ADRs or through mutual funds and country funds. And you also get professional management and you get record keeping, because they invest, if it's an ADR, they invest in ADRs that are all registered bearer securities. So if you look at international mutual fund performance, again, you can get diversification pretty easily through these funds. And if you look at the international funds, the average return over time has been around 19% with a 6% standard deviation. So a return to risk ratio of 3.2. The S&P 500, 14 compared to 14% for the S&P. So basically you're getting, you know, like a 500 basis point alpha on the difference between the S&P 500 and the international fund. And you're getting a higher risk adjusted rate of return because of the diversification benefits that you get going along. And then the US multinational corporate index provides 16% rate of return and 4% with a 4%, or 4x return to risk ratio. So these could be a strategy for you. This could be a table that you would want to show an institutional investor when you're trying to sell your fund. The US market accounts for 40% of the fluctuations in the international funds, and in the multinational index fund, it's 90%. You're really not getting that much diversification. You're getting more from the international fund, but not the multinational corporate fund. The international diversification country funds are the most popular. They invest exclusively in stocks in single countries. So these are the oldest type of funds that have been around since probably the early 90s, maybe as early as the mid 80s, that the designated country funds came out. I know Franklin Fund came out with one of the first, or probably the first, Japanese fund in the mid-80s. There's advantages. You can invest in single foreign markets at very low cost. You individually construct the allocations across the countries, which we'll talk to you in a minute. And you have access to emerging markets. So you may want to do a developed country diversified fund. You may want to do an emerging market fund or a developing country fund, newly developed fund, you know, developed country fund, whatever you want to do. And again, there's different investors that will buy those funds that you design. International diversification, we get it through the ADRs. We usually can't buy international shares unless we have domicile, you know, in those international markets. So if we were going to construct an international fund from here, we would do it through ADRs. The ADRs are foreign stocks traded on US exchanges. The actual receipt gives you the number of shares, and these receipts are deposited at US banks. The bank is the transfer agent. They're denominated in US dollars. The dividends are paid in dollars. They're bearer securities, they're registered, and they provide significant risk reduction within the portfolio if you can start. The World Equity Benchmark shares in 1996, World Equity Benchmark shares of the WEBs were introduced. They're traded on the American Stock Exchange. They were designed by Barclays Global Investors, and Barclays Global Investors was taken over by BlackRock, right down there on Howard Street in San Francisco, Howard II. ETFs are based off of these, so again, you can invest in these. You can go short, you can go long, you can buy right the puts and the calls on these ETF shares. and the MSCI, also the Morgan Stanley indexes. We have country indexes for all basically the major markets and emerging markets. You can also trade spiders, which are long-dated option contracts, so you don't have to play with the three-month rolling option contracts. You can do spiders, which are where you can actually write and buy puts and calls over a year or two period, so you can go out pretty far, which might be a good strategy for some of our institutional clients that want to match liabilities that are coming due with the assets that we put them into. These are open-end funds. They trade at net asset value. The S&P Global 100, which is also traded on the web, that's also traded on the American Stock Exchange. We could use that as a benchmark if we wanted to. And then hedge funds, which have grown very rapidly over the years, which have appealed to accredited and qualified investors based on experience and net wealth and but also institutional investors have invested heavily in hedge funds. The problem is we don't have a lot of information on hedge funds because they're private partnerships, so the information is not disclosed under SEC requirements. They're disclosed to the clients. So it's a very opaque private market. So they're privately pooled investment funds, rapid growth over the last 10 to 15 years, very popular with pension funds, endowments, foundations, and other institutions. The institutions can get positive returns that beat local benchmarks, and they can provide high risk-adjusted rates of return through the diversification process. These funds are extremely flexible. They use dynamic trading algorithms and strategies. They can use leverage. They can use margin. They can go short. They can use derivatives. It can be a long short fund. Maybe you do a long short fund. That's another strategy there. They invest in currencies, bonds, stocks, commodities, real estate. They can invest in anything. They can invest in everything where they see the arbitrage opportunity in the global surface. Again, these are private investment partnerships. They're not registered. And the investors have to be institutional, accredited, or qualified to be able to gain access. There's low correlation amongst the funds because they're in all kinds of different assets. They usually, because they're institutional investors, they can gain access to markets and provide that market access to their clients. They can also gain global macroeconomic exposures, and these funds are called global macro funds, in most cases taking advantage of really large, you know, macro trends. A quantum fund is a perfect example. That's Soros, Jaguar Fund, Global Fund are good examples. You may want to go ahead and research these funds and take a look at them and see how they're structured, see what their styles are. Maybe you can get some return or risk-adjusted returns on them. It'd be interesting to kind of delve in and look under the hood on these things and see how these guys make, you know, all that money. The fees are high. They usually charge about 200 basis points in fees, so 2 percentage points, although I think that sounds a little low. They're going to also charge 2 points on assets under management. They're also going to charge you 20 to 25 basis points, although I think that's low too. It really depends on the fund. They're going to charge 20 to 25 basis points on the performance of the fund above the index returns. These funds could incur large losses, and a lot of these funds or a lot of the hedge funds that were established over the last 5 to 7 years, a lot of them are unwinding their positions and returning the capital to their investors because they haven't been able to beat the benchmarks, so they're just giving the money back. And if you do screw up and lose on a consistent basis, or you have negative alpha in your portfolio, you're going to see massive redemption requests, and that's going to implode your fund too. Although the clients have to sign some a document in the agreement that locks them up for X period of time, so you don't have a run of redemptions on your fund, and you have to liquidate the fund and jeopardize everybody else in the fund. country home bias is funds are, when you're doing an international fund as opposed to a global fund, you're including the U.S., you know, in your country allocation, in your stock selection, and you end up biasing the selection of the securities in your fund towards domestic securities. So there's a home country bias. And this is to really hedge off, you know, inflation, maybe circumvent, you know, any international or legal restrictions. Some of the institutional investors can't invest in international equities and bonds. They can do it through a conduit, or through a fund that's here, but they can't go directly and own real estate or securities or bonds directly in other countries, particularly other country bonds. There's also tax normalization. As you go overseas, there's different tax regimes. If you have home bias, you circumvent the distortions of the different tax regimes. And then transaction costs are lower by doing domestic funds. International diversification, and you can juice your returns by doing a small cap strategy. So let's talk. Anybody have any questions? Go for it.
Or how do small caps juice your...
Because the theoretically, the small cap companies retain more earnings and plow back their earnings back into the company,
okay,
and don't pay out dividends. So they're in hyper-growth mode. So they need the internal capital because it's the cheapest form of capital organically generated by the company. So you plow it back into the company, and then the stock prices will appreciate a lot faster than established dividend-paying companies. And since all of the return is coming from capital appreciation, there's more volatility. Because dividends mitigate the total return volatility of the stock. If you don't have dividends, your total return is going to be more volatile. Okay, so that's kind of the strategy around that. So let's talk. You have a question.
So less risk or more risk in small cap funds?
There's going to be more risk in small cap stocks, but again, you've got to look at it because you may have, even though you got more volatility, you might have less correlation because the small caps are moving in extremely different directions. Okay, so the covariance could be higher, but the standard deviation could be higher. Does that make sense? The covariance could be lower, but the overall standard deviation could be higher because they're all small caps. Okay, but you, theoretically, you would be willing to take on more risk because you're getting significantly more return. So it's the same as if you were building a domestic small cap, you know, fund, you know, portfolio. They outperform a little more risky.
I don't know.
Okay. Any other questions?
Do those appear rollover from the small cap?
In the
small cap,
the private equity side. I mean the hedge fund side. Yeah, you probably would. And some of these funds are open end, but if I was going to design it, I would design it as a closed end. Fund, raise the capital, deploy the capital, have finite life, you know, 3 to 5 year life of the fund, and then liquidate the fund at X period, since it's all institutional, there's no tax consequences, and then have basically another fund basically set up to capture the rollovers in the next fund, or into a series of funds.
That's a lot of money.
It is a lot of money. Exactly. You're going to make a lot of money. If you're charging fees or performance fees, yeah, these guys make a lot of money. It's like the private market offers. Okay, so let's talk about country allocation strategies. Okay. So the way I look at it is there's different ways of being able to rate the countries that you select. And sometimes the selection process is self-determined. I'm going to create a fund. Okay, and we're gonna pick countries that we want to go into. We're gonna pick the industries in those countries where they have comparative advantage. We're gonna pick the companies within those industries that are the best of class within those industries. But I'm gonna pick them either by large caps, mid cap, or small cap. Again, it's what is your portfolio strategy? So from the level one selection process and level one allocation process. So there's three processes, right? There's country, selection allocation, industry, selection allocation, company, selection allocation, okay? How do we pick and allocate across countries? Well, again, it's self-determined. You just have to pick which one you want to use. First is by population, just the size of the market, you know, based on human capital. So China, you know, these are the number of households. So 1394, India 1267, US 322 million, Indonesia 253, Brazilian 202. So I just used the top 10 countries. I took out Africa, and I just used the top, you know, established countries with the largest populations and used the top 10. Sum it up, divide it back. So you can do it by population. Here you could do quality of life indexes. Okay? We do a hypothetical. You can Norway, Australia, Switzerland, Denmark, Netherlands, Germany, Ireland, US, Canada, New Zealand. Those are, would be a strategy. You'd have to come up with the allocation, maybe based on the index. I didn't put the indexes there, but just add up the indexes. Divide them back, there's your weights that you're gonna get. And this could be quality of life strategy that you use. That could be appealing to, you know, more environmentally conscious, you know, institutional investors. Global trade. I didn't use imports. I could use gross trade flows. That would be one way to do it. I used exports, because exports basically are an indication of comparative advantages within the country and the industries and the companies that are in that country. So really export-oriented strategy. So again, you can look at the total export trade and dollar amounts, sum it up, divide it back, boom, you got the weights. These are just the allocations. This is of the total exports globally. These are the countries that capture the majority, or export the majority of goods in the global market. So as you can see, the dominated markets are the Eurozone, US, China, Germany. That could be like your level one segmentation, large, developed. Then you have, it looks like there's a break point here, Japan, UK, France, and Netherlands. And then you have South Korea and Italy. You can figure out the allocations here. You can do GDP, so total gross domestic product is your weighting factor. Obviously, population and households and GDP are going to be correlated, but they're going to be slightly different. So this could be a production-oriented allocation strategy for your portfolio. So China, US, Japan, Germany, Russia, India, UK, France, South Korea, and Brazil. Sum it up, divide it back, boom, there's your weights. You could use foreign direct investment inflows. I wouldn't use outflows, I'd use inflows, because again, as money comes in to countries based on expected productivity gains, profitability, rates of return, it's almost like currency, right? Flows that are coming in. So China, Hong Kong, US, Singapore, Brazil, Canada, Australia, India, and the Netherlands, top 10. So I would probably do, if I was gonna build a global portfolio, I would do the top 10, or the top five. Something like that. If you want to increase, you have to decide how you want to do it. Obviously, the more countries you have in there, the more diversification you're going to have. Stock market capitalization. You can use market cap for the stock markets. Obviously, the U.S. And the NASDAQ, the NYSE and the NASDAQ are the largest. Then Japan, Shanghai, London, Shenzhen, Euronext, Hong Kong, Deutsche, and TMX. You could do a portfolio based on market cap. And then from those exchanges, you can go into the, find the industries, the allocations, you can find the industries that are growing the fastest, you can find the companies that are growing the fastest within those industries. So that would be another strategy. Any questions on strategy? I probably want to take a picture of this. I got the facts, I'm going to check the facts. I took these from the Pocket World and Figures, since I subscribe to The Economist, they sent me this. it has all of these factors in it, and I could probably build a multi-factor model using all of these rankings and performances. So it's a pretty good one. It's pretty up to date. Since most of the data is 2014. So let's do a few problems and then talk about the midterm again, just kind of wrap it up. So we have a Euro investor. He sold Microsoft and bought Microsoft 6 months ago. He invested $10,000 in pounds. He bought the shares at $120 per share. The exchange rate at the time was $1.15 per euro. He sold the shares at $135 per share, and then they converted back into euros at $1.06. So the profit here was 2,100 pounds. And to calculate the return on the portfolio, you calculate the return in the share price plus the 1 to the 1.06 exchange rate minus the 1 divided by 1.15 exchange rate originally divided by 1 divided by 1.15. So that's going to give you the exchange rate component of the return plus the share price return is going to give you 21%. So in this case, the currency appreciated. So you have to tack that on. Another example is you have a Japanese pipe company that invested $10 million in pure discount US bonds in May of 1995. The exchange rate at that time was 80 yen per dollar to the dollar. They liquidated the bonds at $10,650,000 1 year later. And by that time, the exchange rate was 110 yen to the dollar. So they invested 800 million yen to buy $10 million in US bonds. They liquidated at 1,171 million yen. And at the $10,065,000,000 to the 110 yen to the dollar. So you take the 1,171 in yen minus the original investment in yen of 800 million times 100. In this case, they got a rate of return not only on the bonds but also the value in the bonds along with the currency of 46%. The last one is a portfolio calculations. The US and the UK stock market, we have the returns and the standard deviations, we have the correlation, and we have the weights between the two markets. So to calculate the expected return, we have the two weights, we have the expected returns, we multiply the two together to get the expected return on the market. Then you can calculate the variance of the portfolio standard deviation on the between the two markets. So 0.5 squared, 4.43 squared, plus 0.5 squared, times 5.55 squared, plus 2 times 0.5 squared, times 4.43 times 5.55, and the correlation coefficient. So in this case, you have variance of 19.74 and a portfolio standard deviation of 4.44%. So these would be an approach that you would use to calculate the expected return and the portfolio standard deviation, and then divide the expected return by the standard deviation to get the risk-adjusted rate of return. So any questions on that? Okay, so let's finish it for a minute. So talk about the midterm exam again. Three components: first, a individual; second, computer application at lab; third is going to be the group portfolio construction project. Also, on the individual exam, what I'm going to do is, could you bring me the those reports over there? Justin, I put them next to the printer. So what I'm going to do on the individual day, I'm going to pull the questions. Thank you. I'm going to pull the questions from the two research reports that I'm going to pull. pull it from the political economy and business government relations, and I'm gonna pull it from the developing stock markets and emerging economies. It's a little bit out of date, but the theory is correct, okay? So I'll pull the questions from these two reports. We'll also go over global modern and postmodern portfolio theory that we went over there. And then I'm also gonna have you watch, you'll probably watch it in class, and I'll put together, like I did the movie review worksheet that we did on the inside job last semester. We'll do that and we'll watch some of the Kyle Bass videos. You may want to go up and start watching this guy. This guy is totally amazing. He's a hedge fund manager for Hyman Capital Management out of Dallas. He's probably one of the smartest guys I've ever listened to. I mean, just freaking unbelievable. He communicates. I mean, he understands physics and psychology and fixed income and equities and policy and monetary policy, fiscal, he just understands everything when he communicates and ties it all together in the investment strategy for his hedge fund. It's pretty amazing. And he's had a pretty negative view of Japan and China for quite some time because of just the massive over-accommodation, you know, and just massive amounts of sovereign debt that have been issued by the two countries. And just to listen to him assess the sovereign default risk scenarios pretty much convinced me that we will definitely see a financial crisis in sovereign bond debt, probably between 21 and 23, as an incubator. And we run into another recession, which will probably trigger the defaults. Okay? That's all I got, unless you have any questions. We'll take your deliverables, please, and put it in the box.